Shalom, I'm Havi Dreifuss from Tel Aviv University in Yad Vashem, and I'm happy to be here. I want to thank Professor Shai Pilnik, for the director of Emil and Jenny Fish Center for Holocaust and Genocide Studies at Yeshiva University, for having me with you here at this serial talking about Jewish responses to the Holocaust. I was asked by Professor Pilnik to share with you some thoughts after writing a book dealing with the Warsaw Ghetto, especially in its last month of existence. My book, The Warsaw Ghetto, The End, deals with the time between April 1942 and June 1943, the time when the Warsaw Ghetto uprising occurred, as well as the months that came that were before it. Now, usually when we're talking about the Warsaw Ghetto uprising, we're talking about resistance, revolt, rebellion, uprising, and many of you maybe already have used the term Amida, this Hebrew word referring to other Jewish reactions during the Holocaust. Now, when we're talking about the Warsaw Ghetto, we refer to many different aspects of its life, cultural life, religious life, as well as family relations and political activity and other things. But speaking about the Warsaw Ghetto, one can see a very interesting thing. On the one side, when we speak about the Warsaw Ghetto, we talk about many different aspects of its cultural life, religious life, political activity, education, and many other things. But somehow, when we get to the summer of year 1942, when the great deportations from Warsaw Ghetto to Treblinka started, we stop talking about all those different aspects of life and concentrate mainly on the uprising. Now, the interesting thing is that if we look even on the numbers, the vast majority, more than 98% of the Jews who were still living during the Warsaw Ghetto uprising, weren't part of any one of those military undergrounds. They were just Jews who were still living in the Warsaw Ghetto. And the question I wanted to ask myself when I was starting to prepare this book, The Warsaw Ghetto, The End, is what was their part in the uprising? What was their daily life? And what did they believe, fear of in the month that came before? Now, there are many books written about the Warsaw Ghetto and about those times. First of all, we have, of course, Israel Gutzman's book, The Jews of Warsaw Ghetto, of the Warsaw 1939 till 1943. We have Engel King and Leachik's book, as well as many other research. We have so many collection of documents, German documents, as well as Jewish documents in many different languages. And we also have many memoirs written by Holocaust survivors who refer to those times. So the question is there anything new about the Warsaw Ghetto and about the Warsaw Ghetto uprising? And I want to focus mainly on those people. Now, this is maybe the most well-known picture of the Holocaust. It's a picture of the boy with his hands raised up. But I want to remind you that this picture was taken during the Warsaw Ghetto uprising. And what I want to do in the next few minutes is to concentrate on those people and try to understand their life and their fears and their hopes during those days of the last month of the Warsaw Ghetto. Now, to understand that, we have to give a few information points about the Warsaw Ghetto prior to the time that I want to refer to. So just selected events of the Jewish life in Warsaw during the Second World War. I want to remind you that prior to the war, in the eve of the war, about 380,000 Jews were living in Warsaw, and they consisted about a third of the people, inhabitants of the city itself. The war broke out, of course, on the September 1st, 1939, and after about a month, Warsaw surrendered after a long siege. This brought a few months of different action against the Jews, but the Jews of Warsaw were concentrated in a ghetto on the mid of November 1940, when the Warsaw Ghetto was established. Now, I won't get here to the history of the Warsaw Ghetto. I'll just remind you that during its existence, about 80,000 of its inhabitants died from natural causes. Natural causes is not a term I'm using, but something that was written in the documentation, and it means Jews who were starving to death, died from diseases and many other reasons. Now, this routine of death and very difficult life in the Warsaw Ghetto changed on the mid of April 1942, that is actually the night between the 17th and the 18th of April 1942, in what was called later on in the slang of the ghetto, the Bertolomeo night, in which the Germans enter the ghetto and shoot 52 Jews that were in their list. One of them is Menachem Linder, who was a very well-known activist in Oneg Shabbat Archive. And this shooting changed everything in the ghetto, not only because this night was so terrifying, but because from this night and on. Almost every night the Germans enter the ghetto, enter the houses, executed Jews, and there is some kind of a higher degree of brutality in the ghetto itself. It's not only that, but in those months of the spring of year 1942, there are rumors that are starting to come to the ghetto about mass executions of Jews in many different places, as well as specific death sites. Those rumors are coming mainly not only through refugees who are about third of the inhabitants of the ghetto. And I'll give you just one example. This is a postcard written by Roja Kaplan, sent to her husband who was in the ghetto. She was in a small village far away to the west. And she wrote him, "Now on the 21st of January 1942, now everything is shaking beneath me. At this moment, I spoke to someone who came from Chelmno. The same thing that happened to the aunt from Kalish is happening to them. This is not a lie." Now, we don't know what happened to this aunt from Kalish, but her husband Shmuel, who was in the ghetto, knew for sure. And this was not the only information that came to the ghetto. For example, Reich Renitzke, who later on became a very well-known German literature critic, wrote, "In March 1942, I first heard that somewhere in Poland, Jews were put in small rooms and Germans killed by the Germans and killed by gas of a car. I did not believe, and I did not know anyone who thought it was possible." Now, for many different reasons, although those rumors are penetrating the ghetto, the inhabitants of the Warsaw Ghetto don't really believe. They don't really believe that it can happen in the Warsaw Ghetto. They think that it happened in other places for many different reasons. And above all, they don't think it will happen to them. All of this changed when the Great Deportation started in the Warsaw Ghetto, and that is between July 22nd and the September 21st of 1942. That is between the eve of Tisha B'Av and the eve of Yom Kippur, according to the Jewish holidays. During this time, about more than 300,000 Jews, including men, women, and children, are sent to Treblinka and murdered there. Now, this is a great change in any aspect of life of the Jews in Warsaw. And from what once was a community with all its difficulties that was still having some kind of cultural life and political life and education and all the things that we talked, everything changed. As Chaim Aaron Kaplan wrote in his diary, "I do not have words to express what we are going through since the deportation was declared. With one stroke of the pen, the face of Warsaw was changed. Everywhere there is a silence of the graveyard." Now, just to explain how dramatic this deportation is, I want you to look at those numbers. Those numbers are the numbers of the Jews, men and women, according to the age, before the Great Deportation and after that. The women are in red, the men are in blue. And you can see that before the Great Deportation, there were more than 50,000 children under the age of 9. You can see that before the Great Deportation, there were about 70,000 youngsters between the age of 10 and 19. After the Great Deportation, there are only 253 children under the age of 9, and about 2,500 under the age of 19. This is really a destruction of all the life that was before, and you can see that there are almost no people over the age of 60. You can also see that prior to the Great Deportation, there were more women than men in the ghetto. After the Great Deportation, there are much more men than women. We won't have the ability here to refer to all the different Jewish responses during this Great Deportation. I just want to remind you that one of the important responses that many times we don't think about is not only the fight or flight that we hear about, people that spontaneously try to flee from the deportation, or people who even tried to attack the Germans who came after them, but the vast majority of the Jews during the Great Deportation in the Warsaw Ghetto, as well as in many other places, just froze when they were faced with so much brutality and so much mass murder. And this is a very important thing that we must remember, that those deportations, those actions done in the Warsaw Ghetto as well as in other places, is just a true bloodshed. We in the Warsaw Ghetto, we know that more than 10,000 Jews were murdered in the ghetto during the deportation themselves, and those are only the numbers that the Jews managed to record. So the numbers were much higher. And maybe we can see the impact of this deportation with the following footage. The picture that you can see is a picture of Yitzhak Katzenelson, who was a very well-known educator and a writer and a poet. This picture was taken on year 1938 with two of his three children, with Tzvi and Binyamin. And the following picture was taken 4 years later. This picture was taken after his two younger sons, Ben Zion and Benjamin, were murdered with his wife, and he was left in the Warsaw Ghetto, only with his oldest son, Tzvi. So we can really see how the destruction of the Warsaw Ghetto had an impact on the life and the souls of its inhabitants those deadly months of the summer of year 1942. The Warsaw Ghetto changed not only its face in regarding the inhabitants, but also its borders during the summer months of year 1942. The southern part of the ghetto were returned to the Aryan side, and what was left was only the northern part of the ghetto. In this northern part, there were formerly only 36,000 Jews, but we know that those were Jews who got a permission to stay in the ghetto. They had numbers, not numbers on their hand, but some kind of a metal number they had to put on their outer clothes. But we know that there were at least 15,000 wild Jews. Those are Jews who stayed in the ghetto with no German permission. Those Jews were in different parts of the ghetto, and those parts were really disconnected from each other. The smallest part was the bushmaker's shop, where about 4,000 Jews lived. There was the area of the shops, that the shops are factories which were in the ghetto, and Jews were forced to work in those factories in the ghetto. Many of them were concentrated in this area that was called the shop area. And there was a central ghetto, that is how it was called, in which there were some shops in there, in which many workers of platsuvkos, that are factories that were outside of the ghetto, and the Jews of the ghetto had to leave the ghetto every morning, go to those factories, and then return back to the ghetto. On the border, they were checked to make sure that they are not smuggling anything. There were there the people who worked in the Wetterfassung. Those were about 7,000 Jews who had the very difficult work of going through the apartments, the abandoned apartments that were left after the Jews were deported, and just looking what is in those apartments, what can be sent back to Germany. And about 10,000 wild Jews. There were also about 2,000 Jews who were working in the Tebens factory, we'll get to it later on, that was still left in this southern part that were returned to the Aryan side, but it didn't have any connection to the ghetto itself. The feeling of the Jews who were still living in the ghetto in these times was living on a grave of the past, as Alexander Donat said, a mental exhaustion, as somebody anonymous from the Ringelblum archive said, or a mixture of job's terror and God's curse, as Israel Gutman wrote in his memoirs. Now, in order to understand the Jewish responses, we also have to refer to what happened in the German side. And here we have to remember that the Germans had a different war powers between them. Part of it was between military people and the SS. And after the Great Deportation, General von Ginant is writing a very clear letter in which he says that the evacuation of the Jews from Warsaw without advance notice caused considerable difficulties in growth of wartime production. Now, he says he doesn't have any problem with the order to remove the Jews as quickly as possible, but without inflicting any damage to vital military production. Now, you can hear here the criticism, and a person that did not like criticism was Himmler, who answered in some kind of another letter he wrote on October 1942, if there are those who think they can push us aside by using arguments of armament industry interest, when in fact they simply want to protect the Jews and their businesses, we will know how to handle them without mercy. Now you can see this problem within the German forces, and this brought to a visit, a surprise visit of Himmler in the ghetto on January 9, 1943. And this visit, after this visit, he gave a very clear order in which he ordered the SS to deport Jews who are working in Tebens factory and in other factories in the ghetto to the camps in Lublin. Now, what Himmler wanted at this point is to concentrate all the Jews who are working in SS camps, mainly in Lublin, and he wanted the Jews who are working in factories moved to those camps in Lublin, while the other will be murdered. But it's not so simple. And actually, even when the SS is entering, and I won't be able to refer to all the different aspects of it, they are not going to the shop, the area of the shops where those Jews who Himmler ordered were concentrated, but they enter the central ghetto, because from their point of view, they are making some profit of those Jews who are working in the shops, and they can send other Jews from the central ghetto. But when they enter the ghetto, and that is on the 18th of January, 1943, it's the first time when they face organized military actions. And we can talk about the members of HaShomer HaTzair who are joining a group of deportees and attacking the German just at the entrance of the Umschlagplatz. The vast majority of this group was killed, except of Mordechai Nilevich, we all know from later times. There was a group of Dror and Gordonia, other Jewish underground youth movements that became underground members who stayed in their apartment and disobeyed the German orders to show themselves in the street. When the Germans came to the house, they just shot the Germans and fled through the roof. The vast majority of this group, actually except one person, survived. And we also had a group of Bund who were caught with no weapon, and they were just they refused to board on the trains at the Umschlagplatz and were shot in place. Now, referring to all of those different actions of resistance, Tzivi Lubetkin said the following. She said that the January uprising had a tremendous importance, and this is when people, Jews, understood that they can shoot the Germans and even stay alive. And she said the uprising is what stopped the action. All this caused a drastic shift in the Jewish population psychology. Now, this is very important, and for a long time in the history, we were focusing on what those uprising groups, underground groups were saying, but I want to refer to another narrative that was maybe even much more prevalent in the ghetto, and that is of other Jews. For example, in a diary written by Shmuel Winter, who was also an activist of Onek Shabbat Archive, he wrote the following. He wrote that today we mark six months since the beginning of our Khurban, the destruction. He refers to the fact that the 22nd of January 1943, this is when he was writing it, is just half a year after the Great Deportation. And he says, if we would have presented back then resistance, now look what resistance he's referring to it, at least to the extent of resistance presented during the last action, the Nazis would not have so easily exterminated such a large Jewish community. If only back then, Jews would have not gone so easily, but hide, like in the last few days, then certain action would not have taken, it would have taken months. Unfortunately, a quarter of a million Jews had first needed to die in order for the remaining to understand the situation and to come to the right conclusion. Now, this expert of the diary is very interesting because, as you can see, he's talking about resistance, but he's not talking about an organized military resistance. He's talking about a different resistance, a resistance in disobeying those German orders, in staying in hiding place and just making the deportation itself much more difficult. And when we're talking about the time between January and April, those are the time between this, what the resistance group called it, the January uprising, but many Jews, the vast majority of the Jews in the ghetto called it the second action or the January action. But when we're looking what happened between those days and the April uprising, we can see that we're talking about two different narratives. One is of the underground and the other one is of the public. Now, I won't refer to all the different aspects of the underground. I'll just mention that there were two Jewish underground in the ghetto. One is the Zhezhevu and the other one is the Job. The Zhezhevu was established mainly by Beitar people and their commander was Pavel Frenkel. The Job was a coalition of all the other underground and youth movements and political movements, and it was Gordonia and Bund and Dror HaShomer HaTzair, Akiba, Politzion, and the Communist, and Anor HaTzioni, and many and others. And there are many different resembles as well as differences between those two organizations, which I won't detail here. I'll just mention maybe a few of them. Regarding their size, they are more or less the same. The Zhezhevu is about 250 people. The Job is maybe close to 300. Now, the Job is established only on people who are members of ideological movement. That is a group of HaShomer HaTzair and a group of Dror and a group of all of those other political circles. The Zhezhevu is a different story. It's true that there were about 150 Beitar members, but they also accept any other group or people without any reference to their ideological affiliation, and they're accepting them to their underground. The Zhezhevu have some military training, the Job doesn't have any, and both of those undergrounds are focusing in those months between January and April of 1943 on in the implementation of the fighting forces, increasing financial resources to buy more weapons, buying weapons and ammunition, and finding the operational plans for fighting, which were quite different, and I won't refer to it here. Now, those fighting organizations are very important, and much can be said about them. But I want to remind you that we're talking not only about those organizations, but about the other Jews who are still living in the ghetto as well. And they consisted the vast majority of the people. And their point of view was, or their reactions and responses were a little bit different. They were not talking about military fighting against the Germans. They were talking about, first of all, trying to escape to the Aryan side, trying to find hiding places within the ghetto itself, or trying to find permits as workers in the different German factories. So actually, we can talk at this point about many different Jewish responses. Some of the Jews, and those were actually the minority, were those who were part of those underground groups and were thinking about fighting the Germans with weapons. But the vast majority of the Jews were actually trying to struggle in a different way, one that resembles much more what we heard before from in the Diary of Winter. That is, people trying to disobey the Nazi's order, if by fleeing to the Aryan side, if by hiding themselves, or if by trying to just survive in the German factories. All this brings us to the eve of the Warsaw Ghetto uprising, and I want to just to remind you that even in those days prior to the what became the uprising of the Warsaw Ghetto, the Germans are still trying to deport the Jews who are working in factories in the Warsaw Ghetto to concentration camps in Dublin. And it's not easy, because the Jews are not willing to believe any promise of the Germans that Jews will not be sent to Treblinka, but to those working camps. And even when the factories themselves are trying to organize those deportation, it does not work. As you can see in a diary written by Schulz, who was one of the head of those factories, and he wrote just less than a week before the outbreak of the Warsaw Ghetto uprising. And this brings us to the 19th of April, 1943, eve of Passover, to the attempt of the Germans to deport all the Jews from Warsaw, which became, later on, the Warsaw Ghetto uprising. During those days, we have more than 50,000 Jews still living in the Warsaw Ghetto. And what I want to describe now is how in the very first day there is some kind of a different reality that exists in each part of the ghetto, if it's a central ghetto, if it's a shop. And only after 3 or 4 days, we can talk about some kind of a joint experience of all the Jews in the ghetto. And that is people who were hiding in bunkers, what happened to them when they were taken out to the streets, and what happened in the Umschlagplatz. But let's start with what happened with the central ghetto. On the early morning hours of April 19th, the Germans are entering the ghetto by two routes, Nalevki and Zamenhof, and very soon they are finding themselves attacked by one of the group of the Jezhevu in this crossroad of Gensha and Nalevki. Now, it could be that this picture that you can see here was taken at this specific point, but what is more important, that even when they manage to penetrate the ghetto, they are attacked by other groups of the Job as well as by groups of the Jezhevu. Now, this fighting continues on the second day of the uprising as well, and you can see that the main fighting took place in Moronovska Platz, that is in the northern part of the ghetto, where the vast majority of the forces of the Jezhevu were concentrated. But as well as the second day was in the Bushmaker, there was a mine that the underground managed to explode, as well as shooting in the central ghetto. We will refer to what happened in those deserted places, the blue section, later on. What is important here to remember that the situation in each one of those areas was a little bit different. We can use, to try to understand what happened in the central ghetto, we can use a very interesting testimony written by Leon Eiberg, who said, "The destruction in the central ghetto was much more horrifying than one in the Bushmaker shop where he was, because most of those houses were built on an old architectural style, which means that they had no internal metal support. The ceiling were held by wooden beams, and when the fire spread to the rooms, the entire building collapsed like card building while burying all the basements." And actually, from the second day, the Germans are using the fire as a tool to fight the Jews who are still hiding in the ghetto. You can see that after a day or so, they are not afraid of any shots being aimed to them, but mainly from the building that might collapse. And we'll refer to this one later on. In the shop, the situation is different because the deportation started from the central ghetto. And only later, the shops were supposed to be evacuated. And then the Germans are giving some kind of an ultimatum to the Jews who are still working in those factories, demanding them to be evacuated in an ordered way to those camps in the area of Lublin. And in Stubb's report, we can find that there was an evacuation order to 6 a.m. on April 21st. That is the third day of the uprising of the evacuation. One of the Germans who had a factory in the ghetto, a man called Emil Schulz, wrote a diary. And in his diary, he's writing that this evacuation and this ultimatum is a result of the fierce resistance action encountered by the Germans. And the goal is to destroy as quickly as possible the criminal nests, that is how he called them, and the hiding places in the region. So when they're coming to the shop area, they're giving the Jews an opportunity to still just, you know, show themselves and be deported in an organized way to those concentration camps in Lublin. But that doesn't happen. And we can see how this ultimatum was seen from the Jewish side, for example, from the diary written by Mira Pijitz. And she writes, now, Mira Pijitz was part of a family that until this point managed to survive 13 people, including all people, and few children and so on. And she's writing in her diary, "I feel unusual weakness. I can barely stand. What should we do? Even if we think we will be taken to a labor camp, as the Germans are promising, what are the chances that this camp will not become a death camp after a few weeks or months?" Now, her situation is even more problematic because she is still in the ghetto with her father, while her mother and her younger sister are already with all of their belongings in the Aryan side, and she doesn't know what to do, to obey the Germans and just report to one of those evacuation to one of the camps in Lublin or to find a hiding place. And she writes, "Those who decide to go pack their bags. The rest are already in hiding places, and we're still in a vacuum. I refuse to go. I am so afraid. I have a horrible feeling about it. And to stay? But where, in the name of God, where? What shall we do? God, what a hell." And actually, when the order is first given, and we can see it from Schulz's writings and his diary, not so many Jews reported. He wrote on April 21st the following, "When the Jews were supposed to be driven out at 6 o'clock, it was impossible to see even one volunteer. This concentration of people raises fear. However, as the days go on, more and more people show up for evacuation." And if we look at those photos, and I didn't say before, but all of the photos I'm using here are from Stubb report, which were taken by the Germans, we can see this group leaving the shop, that is those walls that you can see behind them, and you can see that they are taken in an organized way. We can even follow this group throughout the street of the ghetto, and we'll return to this picture later on. But what is happening to the Jews in the hiding place? This is what Mira Pijitz writes. She says, "I'm covered with sweat. Oh my God, if only this kid, which is hiding near her, will not start coughing again." And at the same moment, she bursts out coughing. "I cover her mouth with a pillow. Her mother cries and hit me. No, don't strangle her. And maybe I should. My God, what should I do? This kid is one and we are 60. Now, the hours are going on, and then there is noises and blast, and somebody is just knocking on the hiding place door and saying that the Germans gave another ultimatum. Some of the Jews in this hiding place of Mira Pijitz decide to show themselves and to go to wherever the Germans are promising them. And she said that she doesn't know what to do, as well as other Jews in the bunker. And I'm citing again, "I feel I can no longer endure such emotional stress. They, those people who want to submit themselves, consider this pardon as a godsend. One cannot speak with them rationally. And we are still afraid to take the responsibility of trying to convince them. Who knows? Maybe they'll find rescue in that Poniatowa, that is one of the camps in Lublin, and we will get killed here in the bunker. Nobody really knows what will be." And Schulz writes in his diary that on those later hours, they came out of bunkers and halls, and soon the streets were full again with the masses who are willing to move. We can see those Jews who showed themselves only after the second ultimatum in this picture, and you'll try to compare it to the following one. You can see now that in this picture, the ruins that are behind, you can see that the people, those Jews are guarded much in a much intense way, and those we presume, are Jews who showed up only after the second ultimatum. But they too were taken to the Umschlagplatz and later on to other camps. I want to share with you another diary, a diary written by Seve Kokonovsky, this young fellow you can see here. He was a Shomer HaTzeir member, but he married, he fell in love and married with his friend Hadassah Tzinkin during the beginning, in the really just months before the war broke out. And he's hiding in the Warsaw Ghetto with all his family. Again, by a miracle, they managed to survive until this point, about of 13 people in his family. He doesn't have any connection to Mirapizic's family. And they are hiding in a place, and they are seeing what is going on in the ghetto. And he's leaving his hiding place and joining some of the Jews who are still packing those factories and trying to understand what is going on. And this is what he writes. He says that what they think is that in 6 weeks, Leshno Street, this is where they are hiding, will be moved back to the Aryan side, the same way that was done after the first action. And then we will be saved. We will be saved because they prepared a hiding place in the Aryan side. But suddenly, when he's with his friends or talking with those people who are still packing those factories, the Germans are ordering all of them to sit down, and he sees with his own eyes how the house in which his family, his mother, his wife, and all the other members of the family is set on fire. And he says, with a lightning speed, the fire holds house after house. I try to convince myself that all is but my own imagination, that all will end well, and my relative will not be perished by fire. And he says, they, my dear, will not be hurt. He's trying to convince himself. And today is the last day of the action. This is what he is trying to say to himself. They will survive. There is no question. They will leave the ruins and move to our apartment in the Aryan side. He himself is taken to the Umschlagplatz, jumping from the train, going to those apartments and waiting there to his wife and for his wife and his family members. None of them is coming. None of them is joining him. And later on, he also will perish. I'm giving those examples just to understand the differences in between those, the central ghetto and the shops. But those differences were only in the first 3-4 days. After 3-4 days, we can talk about joint realities throughout the whole ghetto, in hiding places, in the streets, or in the Umschlagplatz. Talking about those joint realities, I just want to point out a few things. First of all, in the hiding, in the bunkers, as well as in the apartments, the situation became more and more difficult. I'll give just one example from the only daily diary we have, which was written during the uprising itself. We don't know who wrote this diary. It's an anonymous girl who also draw, as you can see, her bunker plan or the how it was built. And she writes after 5 days, she's writing the following. The last 5 days were difficult in every respect. Since the time when 45 people were accepted to our bunker. Most of them did not have any clothes or food. The situation got worse on Monday at midnight when the power station turned off the electricity. We are facing a difficult problem. How shall we cook? Most people have a supply of food which cannot be used without being cooked. Now, I want to refer to two things. First of all, in most of the hiding place, more Jews were accepted than the place were supposed to be, because if somebody knows of this hiding place, you want him to be within in the bunker and outside of it. That is one thing. Another thing that we have to remember, that many of those hiding places were built in the thought that in half a year the Russians will come and liberate Warsaw. So they built a hiding place for 6 months. And if you're building a hiding place for 6 months, you have to have food that you can cook slowly when the time will come. But if you don't have electricity, that is a problem. And here we can see how people found themselves in a more and more difficult situation. But the situation became even worse when the houses were set on fire. Sometimes the Jews didn't even know that the place, the building in which they are hiding, was set on fire. How could they know if they are just in their bunker? For example, Yecheskel Zuckert writes that he was a child, we heard for hours as if someone is stepping on the top of the bunker. And it took time for the grown-ups to understand that it seems to be falling bricks. The house was set on fire and the bricks crumbled and fell from the ceiling. But not always people understood that the house itself was on fire. For example, another testimony of an anonymous Jew from a bunker in Nalevki 38 wrote, "At about 9 o'clock, we thought of eating supper. The situation was somehow tragicomic. We were surrounded by fire, and we, as if we did not, as if it did not concern us, sat and ate. At about 10 o'clock, I went to wash my hands. I opened the tap and felt warm water. Suddenly, it became clear to me, we are surrounded by fire." But even if people understood that they are surrounded by fire, how can they flee? People in the bunker sometimes found themselves just trapped after the house had collapsed, and people who were hiding in apartments many times just left the apartment and saw that the whole stairs were already ruined by fire. So even fleeing the burning houses was not easy. Those who managed to get to the streets found themselves in a true hell. As we can see in some of the pictures taken in Stroop album, you can see the faces of those Jews that were dragged from their hiding places. You can see their agony. You can see how they cannot even sometimes stand on their own feet. But you can also hear their shock, seeing the destruction in the streets of the city in which they lived for such a long time. For example, this is what this young, anonymous woman wrote in a diary. "I go out into the street, it's burning. Everything is on fire, whole streets. The entire ghetto is a sea of flames. There's no rescue, no one knows where to take shelter. Death prevails everywhere." She's not the only one who described this destruction. Baruch Goldman wrote during the Holocaust the following, "I decided to leave the bunker. The sight I saw went beyond all expectation. Between the walls, one could see a sea of flames, clouds of smoke blotting out the sky. The light was as strong as the daylight. The yard was covered with debris. It made up a scene that cannot be described. More than once during my lifetime, I've seen destruction." And he describes here the two world wars that he took part in. "But the current devastation exceeded all I had seen before." Now, within this destruction, one of the things that many times we did not talk when we referred to the Warsaw Ghetto are endless physical and sexual abuses, as well as mass execution of those Jews. Stroop is given an order that all Jews must undress and be searched for a weapon. And we even have photos taken by the Germans or the Ukrainians. As you can see, I'm not showing those pictures in full because we don't want to use those naked woman pictures in full sight. But if you look at the German faces as well as the Jewish one, you can understand that this is a very important part of what happened in the Warsaw Ghetto. The sexual abuses, rapes, sexual abuses, by the way, of men and women. And one of the questions I had when I was writing the book is, how many details can I bring of those awful atrocities that will not make people just shut the book and go on? And I had to find different ways how, on the one hand, to expose those cruelty, but on the other hand, not to flee people from this subject. But I want to stress that those murders and abuses are an important part of the uprising. Many of the Jews were shot in what was once Zamenhof 19, the building that you can see here. And part of the Jews who were taken out of their hiding place are those who you can see here. And the title written in the Stroop album is of Yiddish Rabbiner. Those are Jewish rabbis. We know who are the Germans who are guarding them. We also know who are those Jews, Rabbi Heschel Rappaport and David Scheinman, and we can see people from the Prager family and others. Those Jews managed to keep their traditional clothes and their sidelocks and their beard until April and May 1943. Now, if we're talking about Jewish responses, this is also a response we should take into consideration. But I must proceed and refer to what happened in the Umschlagplatz. And in the Umschlagplatz as well, the Jews were held in very difficult conditions. And as another man who wrote a diary, a man called P.P., we don't know his real name, Jan P.P. wrote, "For 3 days when he was in the Umschlagplatz, I did not eat. We didn't get any water as well. During the night, only the Ukrainians stayed in the Umschlagplatz. They enter into a hell and party began." And he describes very well those, again, sexual abuses and physical abuses. And he says that all these extract all our strength and all of our dignity. No one rebuilds, no one attacks the Ukrainians. And you can see how those pictures, the only picture we have from the Umschlagplatz, which were taken during the uprising, you can see how well the Jews are being guarded. Another anonymous Jew said that in the Umschlagplatz, people just fade physically and mentally. The last testimony I want to share with you regarding the Umschlagplatz is part of the testimony of Paula Rothschild, and she described who are the people in the Umschlagplatz, and she says, there were their families who came voluntarily from Schul shop with small children and a lot of packages. They have brought all they had because they thought they will need it in Travniki, though that is another camp in the Lublin area. The second group of residents of the Umschlagplatz were our wild ghetto Jews. Those had almost nothing, and she described how wounded they were and what a bad situation they were. Those of Shut said with great confidence that they are going to Travniki, and how dare those wild doubt it? We were not brought here by force. We came here out of our own will, and Shut promised us that we will be sent to Travniki. Even if he does not want to keep his promise, he will be forced to do so, or he will be sent to the front. They were so angry at those who wanted to kill their hope. From the Umschlagplatz, Jews were sent to different camps in Lublin area, some of them to Budzin, Travniki, Poniatowa, but as well as Majdanek and Treblinka. We have a great problem trying to understand how many Jews were sent to each one of the camps because, for example, out of the 800 who came to Budzin, some were brought from Majdanek. And those who came to Majdanek, some of them even went through Treblinka. And we don't have the exact numbers of those in Poniatowa as well. Generally speaking, we know there were about 29,500 Jews who were sent from Warsaw Ghetto to those camps. Some killed right away, as in Treblinka. Others stayed in those camps for quite a while. All the others, and that is more than 20,000 Jews, perish during the Warsaw Ghetto uprising, if it by fire or by executions and other ways of murder. What happened to those Jews who were brought to the camps in Lublin? Those Jews, the vast majority of those Jews, were murdered during the Erntefest, that is the beginning of November 1943, when the Germans killed 42,000 Jews in the camps of Lublin area, among them 18,000 Jews of Majdanek. That means the vast majority of the Jews who were deported to those camps after the ghetto uprising were murdered in the beginning of November 1943. The only ones who survived are the lucky ones, if one can say so, who were sent prior to this Erntefest to another camp, Auschwitz, Hasag, and maybe survived there. I want now to go back to this map I showed you before. And when we were talking about the first days of the uprising, and we could see that the Germans were attacked not only in the central ghetto or the shops, but also in this blue area that was actually deserted of Jews. And this is a very important thing I want to refer to you, because actually we know that there were some kind of fightings, not only by those two military organizations, but by other Jews as well. This aerial photo was taken on the 27th of July 1944, days before the Polish Warsaw uprising of summer 1944. And you can see here the scar of the Warsaw Ghetto, as well as another scar I will want to refer in a second. I want to just remind that after the end of the Warsaw Ghetto uprising, the Germans took prisoners from Auschwitz, Jewish prisoners from Hungary, mainly from Hungary and Italy and Greece, Jews who did not know to speak Polish, and forced them to take brick by brick and just demolish the whole area of the ghetto. So actually, in this aerial photo that was taken on May 1943, you can still see buildings standing, but when the ghetto was liberated, or this area was liberated at the end of the war, this is how the area looked, and this is how the whole area of the ghetto stood. All the houses were ruined. But back to the aerial photo of July 1944, I want you to look at this small scar. Some of you might remember that this small scar is actually the small Tebben's shop that was still in the southern part of the ghetto. Now, this is very interesting because from the one hand, Tzivi Lubetkin from the fighting organization told us that we were disappointed for not being able to have a grasp at Tebben's shop at Prosta Street. So we know there were no fighting fighting organizations there. But we also have Stroop report in which he writes on May 12th the following: the blockade in Prostra Street was increased and then the street was set on fire. One can presume that a considerable number of Jews perished in the flames. From one house made of concrete, Jews were removed and it was blown to prevent it from being used by thugs. Now, when Stroop refers to thugs, he refers to fighters. So from his point of view, Jews in this building were fighting. And here I want to stress something very important. In this report, or this list of reports and documents sent by the JKN, the Jewish National Committee, to the Polish government exile at May 1944, and you can see the date in the right corner here, above in the top right corner, there is a list of documents sent to the government Excel. One of them is about soldiers bez broni, that is soldiers without weapon. And in this document, Hirsch Wasser wrote the following: among thousands of men and women, old and young, resistant desire was born, which erased the natural anxiety and the death fear. The masses realized that by refusing to surrender, they were fighting the enemy in a special way, making it difficult for him to exterminate them. And this can be shown even in Stroop's own testimony when he said, it doesn't matter how many soldiers did the Jewish fighting organization have. And of course, he refers here to both organizations because he didn't know the difference between them. The essence of the problem, from his point of view, was that their action had a chain reaction impact on all of the Jewish society. They may not even know what fire did they light in the minds of thousands of Jews. And I'm bringing those experts just to remind you with what we started, with the fact that during the Warsaw Ghetto uprising, the vast majority of its inhabitants were not part, not of the Jezhevu and not of the Job, and still they were took a central part in the Warsaw Ghetto uprising. Their central part was not by fighting the Germans with weapon, but by trying to hide. And by insisting to disobey the German orders. And this is very important, because if historians don't like to talk about what would happen if, but let's do this exercise for a second. If we would have had only the fighting itself, well, it would have stopped after 3-4 days max. If we would have had only those Jews who were hiding in their places, we were talking about Jews who are still trying to hide in the ruins of the ghetto. But the fact that we had the fighting on one hand and the Jews who were disobeying the German orders, and by that they were part of the resistance as well, this what gave the Warsaw Ghetto uprising its importance impact. And here I want to return to what we talked about. When we refer to the Warsaw Ghetto uprising, usually we're talking about resistance, revolt, rebellion, Amida, uprising and other things. We, I think, should remember two things. First of all, that when we're talking about Jewish responses to the Holocaust, there were many different responses during those times. It's not only those religious responses, the people that just froze facing the brutality. But when we're talking about Jewish responses of the Holocaust, and when we're talking about Jews who are taking part within the fighting organizations, we must remember that part of this fighting was not only fighting with weapons, but also refusing to obey the German orders. And this, I think, is an important part of the history of the Warsaw Ghetto uprising, as well as the last months of the Warsaw Ghetto existence. Thank you for listening to me, and I apologize for sharing with you such a difficult part of this history of Warsaw Ghetto. I want to thank also Professor Shai Pilnik for having me in this area of Jewish responses to the Holocaust, as well as to the Emil and Jenny Fee Center for Holocaust and Genocide Studies at Yeshiva University. So I do hope that this lecture, like all the other lectures of this area of Jewish responses to the Holocaust, will raise new questions, new discussions, all of them stemming from those difficult times of the Holocaust, including the Warsaw Ghetto and its last months of existence. Thank you.